Welcome to George Mason University's Studio A. My name is Rick Davis, and today our guest is Ted Leonsis, Vice Chairman Emeritus of AOL and owner of the Washington Capitals, and most recently, film producer. Please welcome Mr. Leonsis.
Nice to be here.
Great to have you. In 2007, you embarked on a bold new direction in an already eventful life and became a film producer. Can you tell us a little bit about what inspired you to do that?
I was on vacation with my family and I ran out of things to read. I went to a bookstore and all they had to read was old New York Times. And so I started reading sequentially every section of the paper, the metro section, the weather, and I came to obituaries. And I came upon an obituary that said, noted author and historian dies. Had a picture of this woman named Iris Chang. And I read through the obituary, and it was a very moving obituary. She had won a Pulitzer Prize for writing a book called The Rape of Nanking. And afterwards, I threw the obituary in the garbage, and as I walked through the hall and the room that day, that face kept staring at me. And before I left, I literally pulled it out, went home, did a Google search on her, and was amazed that there was a time in history called the Forgotten Holocaust, two words I thought should never be together. And as I did more research, I just found and was grabbed by the story of how individuals stayed behind in Nanking, China, created a safe zone and saved 250,000 people, and became very moved to make a film and tell their story.
Was the idea of making a film, did that occur to you at the same time as the insight into the incident, or did it just start to grab you in a different
Well, I've always been a film buff, although I never really thought I would make a movie. I just didn't know any other way to really tell this story. There had been some books written. They had reached very, very small audiences, and you couldn't bring alive the messaging and the story. And there is something magical when you bring people into a communal setting and they watch in a theater. The idea grew to this concept that I've coined a term called filmanthropy, where you can use the medium as a platform to shine a light on a very, very tough subject that a big studio wouldn't touch. You can activate volunteerism. You can create a platform for charitable giving. And because all the assets are digitized, you can then use the internet and give it away for free. And so a lot more people can get involved in that discussion.
How did you go from that insight into then assembling a production team and hiring the artists and essentially becoming a production company?
Well, I'm an entrepreneur. I love startups. And I have to say, running a film production business was like doing a startup. When I first started my first company, when I was 24 years old, it was a publishing company. I'd never been a publisher before, and you kind of learn as you go. And I frankly started by reading everything I could about documentary filmmaking, and I called the president of CAA and demanded a meeting. And after a couple of emails, I went out to see him, and he saw I was very passionate about this subject. I felt that this could be a Schindler's List kind of film. He introduced me to some directors. One of the directors had won several Academy Awards. And we hit it off. And we decided that I would finance this and produce it, and he would be the director. And we put together a team that eventually got up to about 40 people. Took a couple of years to do it. And I'm one of the lucky ones. You know, the film did very well. It was accepted at Sundance. It's been in about 50 film festivals. It's in theaters right now, and HBO bought it. They'll show it starting in May. And the film's been a hit internationally. It's the number one best-selling box office foreign documentary in China's history.
Wow, so, and that's a big market.
It's a big market, although I will say that even though the film's considered a winner, it's very frustrating as an independent filmmaker to see how difficult it is to get films distributed. And I feel for independent filmmakers. Sundance has become such an important marketplace. And I made a second film that premiered this year. And they received 9,000 films, and they showed about 125, and 8 got bought.
Wow.
So it's harder to get into Sundance than it is to get into Harvard.
And many fewer graduate.
Many fewer graduate. Like. And so to me, that model is broken. Mm-hmm. And so I'm going to spend some time and effort in the future trying to break through that logjam using my experience in the internet and broadband programming to try to find ways to get new distribution.
Let's look at the trailer for Nanking, and we'll talk about it after we show it. But it really has a nice sort of encapsulation of all the various aspects of the film.
I think everyone is here. If you'd all please take your seats, we can get started. What I am about to relate is a story which I feel must be told. I believe it has no parallel in modern history.
5 air raids on Monday and 1 on Tuesday. I'm writing this during our 61st.
An international committee desires to suggest the establishment of a safety zone for civilian refugees at or near Nanking.
Men are not asked to leave their ships when they are in danger, and women are not asked to leave their children.
One can't help feeling that leaving right now would be passing up an opportunity for service of the highest kind.
The enemy creates a desert, calls it peace.
Gallons of civilian blood flowed today.
This is a hell I had never before envisaged.
It was hell today, the blackest day of my life.
I do not regret having stayed on here, for my presence has saved many lives.
We keep asking ourselves, how long can this last?
We just can't all get through this alive.
This memory will remain with me forever.
That is an incredibly powerful piece of film, and it's just the trailer. One of the things that it brings to the forefront is the artful combination of archival footage and dramatic readings by some very well-known actors. Can you talk about that strategy for making the film?
Well, in order to reach a large audience, I think you have to grab people, and we live in this celebrity-soaked culture, and so by getting actors and actresses, I knew we'd get some attention. But more importantly, our issue was that we were able to track down 80 survivors who were all in their 80s and 90s in China, and they had never been put to film before. And we were able to go to Japan and find soldiers at the end of their life who were perhaps seeking atonement and would confess on camera. And there was an amazing amount of footage available that we got all around the world in terms of newsreel. But there was no way to bring alive the Westerners who had stayed behind. And that was really the hook for me. I ask people all the time, close your eyes. You're halfway around the world, you're married, you have children, you have a career, and an invading army is coming in to take over the town. Your president has sent boats and planes to get you out. And everyone from that country that has any money gets out of town. So it's only the poorest of the poor, and you decide to stay behind, unarmed, to help. Who are these people? What's the motivation? And after a lot of research, we found literally thousands of pages of journal entries, diaries, letters home, and the most passionate, articulate words you could ever imagine, eyewitness testimony. And so as a documentarian, what we decided to do is not have a point of view, to just approach this subject from a 360-degree angle and have the words come alive of the eyewitnesses, and then put on camera what the people who were there saw, and then have the journalists' words. And so I believe that the conclusions that were reached were unassailable. Now, there's many in Japan that deny that this episode ever happened, and now I'm starting to take it a little personally, because you say, well, that means everyone on camera is lying. All these people who stayed behind, Minnie Vautrin, one of the characters in the film literally wrote 1,100 letters, sometimes four or five a day, documenting exactly what she saw. And I just felt that their words needed to come alive, and these actors and actresses were so gifted, and they really did them justice.
Yeah, the montage of the documentary footage and then the essentially eyewitness testimony is really powerful. I know that our students here have some questions to share with us, so let's turn to the studio audience. Who has a question for Ted Leonsis? Yes.
Hi, my name is George, and my question is, how actively were you involved in the production process of Nanking?
I did total immersion. I went to China. I spent probably 300 hours in the editing bay. I was doing the interviews. My son, who at the time was 16 years old, I dropped him off at the National Archives. We're actually going to show the film at the archives next Wednesday with the National Archivist. And he found long lost 70 years in the dustbins, a Holocaust film that was shot in the hospital. And we were able to resurrect that. And to be honest, it was showing that film to the director, Bill Guttentag, that gave him the confidence there was enough material here to proceed. So it was a real family-oriented, all of us rolling up our sleeves and being involved every step of the way.
That's remarkable. Do we have another question from the floor?
My name is Mahad, and I was wondering, how did you recruit the director and the writer?
Money. and to be honest, passion. I'd say that Bill had won an Academy Award for Twin Towers a couple of years ago, and very talented guy. And I just said, this is a forgotten Holocaust, and in a time when Americans are looked at without popularity around the world, these are people that are worshipped as gods and goddesses, not because of their power or wealth, but because of their acts of kindness. And there's just so much going on in this story. There's this time in history that's long forgotten. There's this tension between China and Japan still today over this time in history. There's the personal gut check of that there are heroes amongst us. These were ordinary people that stood up to insurmountable odds and saved 250,000 people. I mean, who are these people? Yeah. What motivated them? How did they do it? And I think the combination of making this a big time film with big actors, making sure that it was historically really accurate, bringing in actors like Woody Harrelson, the romance of it and the story behind it, and then you all get hooked into the cause. Mm-hmm. You start to relate to these people who survived in their story, and you fall in love with the characters, and so that was really how we did it.
One of the truisms about filmmaking is always you have to start with a great story, and you started with one heck of a great story. We have another piece of film from Nanking that it would be a good time to show, and this is just about a 60 to 90 second clip that really shows the intensity of the filmmaking style. Let's have a look.
Miss Vatrin ran to us and begged us to claim someone. She told us if we claimed a man, we would save a life.
As long as you had a relative, the Japanese would assume you were not a soldier.
There were 2,000 or 3,000 young men, some soldiers, some not. We each claimed someone. All day I watched her running back and forth across Jinling in this work.
Sometimes one gets weary of spirit. There is so much suffering, so many in such difficult and impossible circumstances, it makes one hopeless. And when will it end?
I can see little indication of God in the tremendous wave of cruelty and greed that has engulfed a big piece of our world.
I wish Emperor Hirohito could see the mangled bodies of these simple Chinese common people, which his spokesmen profess to love so much. Or that I could carry some of the men and women with legs blown off into the elegant parlors of the rich Americans who fatten on selling war supplies to Japan. They would probably worry more about their rugs than about the wounded.
Such a powerful piece of film. Would you like to comment on any of the incidents that are portrayed there?
Who writes like that?
Yeah, yeah.
No, it's not email or SMS texting. These people, they were poets. They were pursuing a higher calling. There was their moral obligation to stay behind. And what they witnessed was hell on earth. And they were able to shine light in the darkest of times. And so what we just saw was really their reflecting on what they were dealing with on a day-to-day basis. When this was happening, when I first found the story, it was right after Katrina. And there were so many parallels to me. You know, people saw the hurricane coming. If you had any money, you left town. The mayor left town. The police left town. The poorest of the poor stayed behind. There was one emergency room doctor who stayed behind. Well, in Nanking, there was one emergency room doctor who stayed behind. And the parallels were just striking to me on what motivates people to stand up to insurmountable odds and get to work and try to save lives and try to do the right thing the right way. And I do think in my personal life journey, I'm very interested in that. I am very interested in what is the higher calling, what is it that can lead someone to a self-actualization and a higher level of happiness. And I think these people did that. Although most of the people, I was joking with someone the other day saying I was going to call the movie No Good Deed Goes Unpunished. When you watch the film, many Vatran, who saved 14,000 young girls, 1 year to the day after she left Nanking, she committed suicide. Mm-hmm. She just felt that even though she saved so many, there were so many that she couldn't handle. John Rabe, who was a Nazi, he was, other than Oskar Schindler, probably the only other good Nazi. In this 1937, obviously, before Hitler really takes off in World War II, he led this group. He saved tens and tens of thousands of people. He goes back to Nazi Germany with film to say, stop the madness. And his reward is the Gestapo burns the film in front of him, throws him in jail. And finally, the good people of China, whose lives he had saved, they pass the hat and they come and rescue him.
And you mentioned the writing, the poetry of the writing. Do you think those people felt a need to just emotionally unburden themselves, or did they have an eye for the future or the wider world?
Well, I think two things. I do think that it was cathartic to be able to write it. I also think that they knew this was, CNN wasn't there.
Yeah.
There was no way to tell this story. And back in the day, when a conquering army came in, they took over the television and the radio. And this was really the first war that had eyewitness testimony and documentation. As I said, this film that we found was devastating and was used at a war tribunal afterwards to hang and execute 25 of the leaders from the war.
You've talked about having a sense of purpose, and you use that wonderful word filmanthropy, which I think you invented. Can you talk a little bit about your efforts using filmanthropy and where that's leading you?
Well, I want to right some wrongs.
Yeah.
And I think film is, and documentary nonfiction film is a great way to do that. And I do think if you look objectively, that media, if used the right way, is unbelievably powerful. From my times early on at AOL, I mean, while we built the big business, there really was a higher purpose to it. Giving the tools to people to level the playing field to get access to information was very important to us. Being able to share democracy, CNN helped to bring down and end the Cold War, right? Mm-hmm. By being able to show their programming around the world. And, I look at a film like An Inconvenient Truth. That was a $2 million movie. It's probably done more to raise the consciousness of our planet on how fragile our ecology is than anything before it. And so, and I look at a lot of Hollywood fare, and I find it offensive. I don't understand. I went to see the best-selling film 2 weeks ago called Jumper, probably cost $150 million to make. I didn't get it. Mm-hmm. It was like, well, why would we spend all this time? I know we want to suspend our disbelief, but it was a terrible movie. And so, you know, I have the means right now to go tell some of these stories and to try to do good with it. Mm-hmm. My second film, called Kicking It, deals with homelessness. And it shows the power of how sports can help transform lives. And I want to build thousands of soccer fields. And I want to help these homeless shelters and the Homeless World Cup that promoted it. And I think you can reach out and grab an audience and then use the internet to facilitate this kind of sharing and charitable giving and volunteerism and activism. And, you know, I think that there's a lot of people that want to do good work, and they're not going to succumb to the pressures of Wall Street and a Hollywood studio system.
Was Kicking It also a serendipitous discovery, or did you have a plan for
Someone approached me who had been out filming, a young, great filmmaker, local filmmaker named Susan Koch, and she showed me some raw footage, and I got it immediately, and I put together a group, and I said, okay, you do the creative, I'll help a bit, and I'll do all the things that a producer does. I'll finance it, I'll get it distributed, I'll do the advertising, I'll get it into Sundance, I'll get the word out. And as I said, we sold the film at Sundance to ESPN, who's going to show it all over the world, and Liberation Entertainment's bringing it into theaters, and Netflix will bring it out on DVD.
And it'll get soccer fields built.
Hopefully.
Which is very cool. That's filmanthropic.
It is.
We have some more questions from our students, so let's turn to the audience again. Who else has a question for Mr. Leonsis?
Hi, my name is Margo. I read your bucket list, and I was wondering how you came up with it.
I think you're referring to my list of 101 things to do. But the bucket
Not
list
the
was
film
a
of
terrible,
the same name, right?
Terrible film. when I was young, I started a company when I was 24 years old. Mm-hmm. I was very fortunate. A couple of years later, I sold it. And I made a lot of money. And I'm a product of an immigrant family. And I had been raised to be successful. Mm-hmm. And so I declared victory. I thought I had won. And then I got on a plane, and the plane crashed. Mm. And if you want humility, face death. And it's nothing like you see on television. And maybe that's why I've been so inspired by heroes, because I wasn't thinking of anybody but myself. And on the way down, I prayed really hard. It's amazing how religious you get, and spiritual, I guess you should say. And I said, if I live, I promise I'll play offense with the rest of my life. And obviously, I made it through. And my concept was, I wasn't happy when I was facing death, because there was unfinished work, but I didn't have a roadmap of or scorecard on, well, when I finally do pass away, what would be the scorecard of wins? How would I know I had lived life without regret? So I made a list of 101 things to do before I die. My goal is to get all 100 of them, all 101 mm-hmm. checked off. I think I have 72 right now. And it does show the power of visualization mm-hmm. and aspiration, because so many of the things that I listed seemed unapproachable. Now, I said 20 years ago, own a sports team, win a championship. That's why I bought the teams. Yeah. I said, win an Oscar. I said, win an Emmy. I've won an Emmy for Live 8, which was something, mm-hmm. a show I did with Bono, where we broadcast
also charitable
concerts.
Purposes.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And so my goal is to get all 101 of them done. I got to go into outer space. I have to get a hole in one. I have to give away a lot of money. And I hope that when I do finally go, I'll have a smile on my face.
And your list is on the internet. It's a very interesting, it's a great list. Who else has a question? Yes.
Hi, my name is Clint, and I was wondering, what advice would you give to future entrepreneurs also interested in film?
Well, I do have a couple of observations that the people I've met in the film business are the most talented and creative people I've been around. And creating a film is like being a CEO of a startup. So the skills that are necessary, raising money, managing talent, living to deadlines, making a product that a consumer will enjoy, doing the marketing plans, getting them distributed, it's very analogous. The payback is not the same. If I invest $2 million in a startup Web 2.0 software company, my expectation is that that company can scale and grow really fast and I can get 10 times my investment. Mm-hmm. I don't think anyone makes any money on making films. So the films have to be deeply personal. They have to be about something that you care about, because for the most part, making an independent film, you're not going to make any money.
What's next for you? You kicking it is making its way into the system.
I want to find a way to get young filmmakers' films distributed widely by using Web 2.0 tools and technologies to break through the clutter. I also want to find a way to change the business model. Asking consumers to pay money to go watch an analog product, fighting traffic and going into a theater, seems like an idea that was very quaint in the 40s and 50s. Mm-hmm. But we all live in Moore's Law and the network effect, faster, cheaper, better, till it's free. Content should be free. Advertisers should support it. There's a billion people around the world, you know, that are connected to a high-speed connection now on the internet. We should find a way to get those films, certainly that didn't make it into Sundance, distributed. And I'm going to put some time, effort, and energy to try to fix that problem.
That sounds like a fascinating endeavor. And I want to thank you for spending time with us today in Studio A. Ted,
thank you very much.
This has been Studio A. My name is Rick Davis. Thanks for watching.